How is everyone? Are you really doing good? You know what? I'm seeing some faces that are new and some faces that I've seen before. I've seen you before, right? You too, and you too? Welcome back. Mommy and Daddy out here? Welcome back, parents. Wow, yes. Hello, Elizabeth and children. Listen, I have a story for you. Yesterday, we heard our dog barking. And that's normal, right? Dogs are supposed to bark. But Max doesn't always bark, okay? Because he's a spoiled dog and he likes his family, and wherever we are, Max likes to be, so he doesn't have to bark a lot. But I was over at my neighbor's house, at my friend's house, and Max was barking really, really weird. And right before I left, one of our other little friends was over, and I heard him say, "There's a cat in the tree." And I thought, okay, whatever. So I was over with them, I was talking, and then I looked out and I saw Max actually, you know, trying to get, like, just doing this. Not actually climbing, but because it was high, but I'm sure he really wanted to. Because there was a nice big cat up in the tree. And you know what? I just continued visiting, and then we went over. I went over, and I thought it was very strange. Hold it. There's a cat in a tree. And Max is barking. Most cats would have what? When they see a dog. What? What do they do? They run away. Okay. So, why was Max still barking? So we realized when I went out that that cat wasn't just waiting to be barked at or waiting for us to go out there and look. He was actually stuck in the tree. He was stuck in the tree. And not only that, he looked scared. You know what, honey? That's what was puzzling. Why was he up in the tree, and why wasn't he climbing down? That's when we found out that he was really stuck. And I started thinking, man, this cat. So Vanessa climbs up in the tree, and she's terrified that that cat is going to scratch her, but she was brave enough to get up in that tree, but he was so scared that he wasn't helping. So we needed to move the ladder, and then Daddy got up in the tree. He's not really my daddy, but her daddy. The pastor got up in the tree. And then...
I'm glad you made that tree.
Yes. And then it was hard for him to get the cat because the cat was scared. Have you ever thought of a time when you are so scared that you couldn't move? A time that you knew what you had to do. If you're a cat, you climb up, and then what? You can climb down, or you what? You can jump down, right? But this cat was so scared that it couldn't move. And I started thinking about the Bible, because you know what? Every story that God gives us, he actually gives us a way to go back to the Bible. So I'm going to read to you what I thought after that. Now let me tell you before I read this, we were able to get the cat down, okay? We were able to get the cat down, but he was so scared. That's why he couldn't move. Okay. Exactly. Now, in Philippians 4, 6, it says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guide your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. You know what? That kitty cat could not get out of a place where he knew he could get out of, because he's a cat, but because fear overtook him. But when you get in that place, when sometimes you get so afraid that you can't move, I want you to remember that God is always there. You pray, and he is going to take care of you, okay? How did we get the cat down? We actually grabbed him with a towel and then kind of tossed him. But he landed okay. Okay? So let me pray for you. Ready? Are you ready to pray? Let's close our eyes, please. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for so many things that you give us in life, things that you allow us to see, things that you allow us to witness, people that we meet, and situations that we go through. I pray, Father God, for all of us here, but in a very mighty, special way. I pray for the children. I pray that during those times where they get frightened, that they can hold on to your word and know that you are going to take care of them because they are praying for that. Bless them and their families. Bless us all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may go to your seats quietly. Thank you.
Many years ago, when I first became an Adventist, I was reading something, and I'm not sure which book it was in, and Ellen White was talking about a lady who had suffered much deprivation, and later in her life, as she was older, God blessed her with more, and though she had been faithful to him all the time when her life was hard, when she had more, she had a lot of trouble giving to God. And that story, for some reason, always stuck in my mind through those years when we were struggling to pay medical bills, trying to keep kids in church school, after my husband died, and things went very sour for me for a little while, and I remember saying to God, you promised you would be my husband. If I had a husband, I wouldn't be in this situation. And he was, you know, he took were sometimes very hard, very tight. And in September, I was able to pay off my house. And things are different now. And every day I say, Lord, don't let me go the way of that lady. Don't let me forget you when things are better for me. Because in every stage that we are in every part of our lives, the devil has a plan to pull us down. And we have to be always alert to that, of what our temptations are and what responsibilities God gives us for giving to him and taking care of other people in every stage that we're in. So I challenge you today to put God first, whether you're struggling to pay church school bills or medical bills, or whether you're trying to put food on the table for your kids, or whether you're doing better in every stage, say to God, what is my accountability to you here? What can I do? What can I give? And where is the place for me in your work? Will the deacons please stand? Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much that you are there. We can turn to you when we're in need. We can turn to you when we're not. But we always need you. And we always want to serve you with our time, with our money, and with everything we have. Please help us to be faithful to you for Jesus' sake. And please use these offerings in your work for Jesus' sake. Amen. I mentioned earlier about my biology class, and I'm struggling with biology. But when I'm there, I think one of the most important things that I've learned in college since I've been there is what I don't know. And I don't want to engage my biology professor in a conversation beyond what I know. I don't believe in evolution. I believe in a 7-day creation week, but I keep asking the Lord to show me when to say something and when to keep my mouth shut, which, those of you who know me, that's a big struggle for me. On Wednesday morning, I want to say something right now to the grandparents. Really listen to what I'm saying to you. I have a grandchild that I spend the night at his house several nights a week because his dad works nights and he's divorced. And you know, those of you who are grandparents, you know you have limited power in your children's lives. The real authorities in their lives are their parents, and you do what you can to support them and support what they're doing. But sometimes if your children aren't taking their kids to church, or you know, they're not reading the Bible to them at home, that's not you know, you can pray for them and you can do everything you can and you can share Jesus with them, but you're not the main authority in their life. And you know that, and you wonder how much effect you have. Well, I always pray with Mason. I read the Bible to him. We talk. But I didn't really understand the effect until he told me a story the other day. We were in the car. He said, you know, the other day they started talking about evolution in school. He said, I'm in the 8th grade. In 6th grade, we didn't hear any evolution. 7th grade, they didn't say anything about evolution. Now, evolution. And he said, and I told the teacher, I said, where's your proof? I want to see some proof. I don't think I came from a monkey. I want to see proof. He said, we have proof. We have a book. We have proof. God told us he made us. I was dumbfounded. And he said, and when I got all finished, he said, everybody almost, he said, there was a few science people in there, but most of those kids, they all clapped. He said, and the teacher, she didn't say a word. She just said, okay, now we're going to study leaves. Pray for your grandchildren. Talk to your grandchildren. It works. It matters. Today, I want to lift up Shelda Majdi, who's in a car accident, has a broken femur. I don't know a lot about anatomy, but I know a broken femur is a really serious thing. And we want to keep Deborah Reeves in prayer and Jackie Armstead and Ide Candia. And there are probably at least 15 other people here who have a serious issue that needs prayer and that I'm missing your name. But I want you to know that God knows exactly what that issue is. And I want to invite all of you who would like to bring your concerns, your praises, up here and join me as I pray. Please do so. This day, first to praise your name. You are so bountiful in your blessings. You love each one of us individually, personally, separate from anyone else. That is an awesome thing. I stand in awe of the love you have for us. And I ask you, Lord, to constantly remind us of the things that you do for us. So many go unnoticed by us. Help us to realize and to notice those blessings you give us. Because none of us here, not one, is without blessing. No matter what our situation is. And Lord, I want to come and thank you. We do thank you, Lord, for all those blessings.
for loving us, for taking care of us. We thank you for being God, for keeping all the heavens in place, for all the minute little things you do for us every day. We come asking forgiveness because we let you down. Sometimes it's in the car when somebody cuts us off. They don't even know how angry we are. Sometimes we jut out and never give another person a chance. Sometimes it's in the way we treat our family or the way we act at work or school. Lord, please help us to do better, to be examples to others of what a Christian is like, what effect you have had on our lives. Help us to hold that responsibility in our hearts. And Father, we come in with petitions for health and healing for every single one of us in our families who are sick, for anybody who is hurting and lonely, for the challenges that we face, whether they're money or physical problems, whatever it is, Lord, we ask for help. We know you love us and you want us to come. You give us examples in our own lives. Would we deny our children something good for them? No, we would not. And we know you will not. And we ask. And we thank you for listening to our petitions and for answering them, Lord. In the name of Jesus, for Jesus' sake, amen.
Amen.
Scripture reading for today is Jonah 2, verses 1 and 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the stomach of the fish, and he said, I called out of my distress to the Lord, and he answered me. I cried for help from the depth of Sheol. Thou didst hear my voice.
Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I know I did that bad. Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I pray that the song ministers to you. I know that all of us are going through something, but if we stand on God's word, he is faithful.
Amen.
And because he is faithful, we can make it through. Amen.
Thank you.
Beautiful song. Good morning, everyone. I'd like to take this time to welcome you to our church, and those of you who are here for the first time, we want to say thank you. God bless you. We hope that this is not the last time that you worship with us. We also like to take the time to welcome our internet audience, and I know there are some people watching even as I speak right now. So Nana is watching. We want to say hi, Nana. We also want to send a special welcome to Lisa McPherson, who's watching, because this past week she had surgery, and she's not able to be here today. So we want to remember several people in our prayers, and talking about prayer, we want to invite you to come to prayer meeting every Wednesday at 7 p.m. here in our church. And these are some of the people that we need to remember in our prayers. There may be others as well. We need to remember those people as well. As far as prayer, we need to pray for the people in Mexico. As you know, there was a monster storm that hit the western coast of Mexico. In fact, my home state, where I was born, was hit almost directly by the storm. I was talking to one of my cousins who lives in Canada, but we have family down in Mexico, in that part of the country. And praise the Lord, they're okay. Just a lot of rain and wind and those types of things, but no loss of life so far as we know. We need to remember them in our prayers. This week, we have a special program here in our church, and we'd like to take this time to invite you to come out. And that is the annual biography tea that is put out by the TLC students. And at this time, we would like to invite the students to say a few words about this program.
Hi, happy Sabbath. I'm Wilbur Wright.
And I'm Orville Wright.
Of course you know that we invented the first airplane. But did you know I never could go to college because of this hockey incident? In my senior year of high school, I was in a hockey game, and someone hit me with their stick in my mouth, lost half my teeth. And then, because of the cost of replacing the teeth with fake teeth, I could not go to Yale University.
And did you also know that my friend Ed Science and I were arguing for a bag of popcorn, and we finally made a decision that he kept a bag of popcorn and I kept his printing business. And later on, I sold him back the printing business, and he gave me money for it. And with that money, my friend Wilbur and I bought the bicycle shop. And did you also know that by studying God's creation, we found out how the bird flies, and that's what helped us make the airplane?
To learn more about us and other amazing people, like Abigail Adams,
Sitting Bull, and Pele, please come join us to Biography Tea, which is on Thursday, October 29th at 6 p.m.
Hope to see you there.
All right. So make plans to be here. Also, on tomorrow, we have a special program for all the families, everyone in the church, the community. I'd like to invite you to come out from 2 to 7. We're going to have some fun fellowship and things like that. And another announcement coming up, some events that are coming up quickly here. On the first weekend in November, we have Lani Milashenko, who's going to be here with us. He is the former speaker for the Voice of Prophecy. And so he's going to be speaking to us on Friday, also Saturday afternoon. So it's going to be a special program. And we plan to have a baptism in the afternoon. So we'd like to invite you to come out and be part of that. And then the following week, on the weekend of the 13th, 14th, and 15th, we have Chef Mark Anthony, who is going to be here. And of course, Chef Mark Anthony is featured on 3ABN, the Hope Channel. And so he's going to speak to us on Friday, also on Sabbath morning, Sabbath afternoon. And you don't want to miss on Sunday, he's going to do a cooking show and a free, notice, I want to emphasize, free dinner. All right? So that's going to be all the information, more detailed information is in your bulletin, and that is going to be on Sunday at 3 p.m., the cooking show, and then after that, the free dinner. So we want to invite you to come out for that. Also, on next Sunday, November the 1st, we have a business meeting. We'd like to invite all the members to come out and be present at this important business meeting as we look at the future of our church here. All right, I'd like to invite you to bow your heads as we seek the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, today we thank you once again for the blessing of opening your word. And we pray, Lord, that right now you may come and visit us through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. May you speak to our hearts. May all of us, Lord, be attentive to what you have to say today. We thank you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. 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 2 weeks ago, we began a series on the book of Jonah. And we entitled the series, Runaway Prophet. You know, there is a little bit of Jonah in each of us. We have this prophet of God, called by God, to give a special message to this particular city, this ancient city of Nineveh. And he didn't want to go. Have you ever said, I don't want to do it, I don't want to go? I think all of us have said that before. And so we have this rebellious prophet of God. Instead of running to God, he was running away from God. And so we looked at chapter 1. This morning, we're going to look at chapter 2, all right? And we'll entitle the message, It's Time to Pray. Now, as we looked at the story of Jonah last week, we noticed that God gave him specific instruction to go to Nineveh. And of course, Nineveh from Joppa was 550 miles away. And you could say that's not very far, but when you think of the modes of transportation that people had at that time, it wasn't close at all. Not only that, not only was it far, but it was also dangerous. As we looked at last week, this was called the Bloody City. And the reason for that is because it was dangerous, not only at night, but it was also dangerous in the daytime. Third thing that we looked at was the fact that it was a different culture, a different society with different values and things like that. And so Jonah, as he heard the message of God to go to the city, he said no. Instead of going to Nineveh, he went 2,500 miles away to this city in Tarshish. Now, Tarshish is southern Spain. Why did he go to southern Spain? I don't know. Maybe he wanted to learn Spanish, you know? But nevertheless, he was on his way to Tarshish. We said last week that we are either on our way to Nineveh or on our way to Tarshish. That's it. There's only two ways. And so if we are more concerned about ourselves and our image and our convenience, we are on our way to Tarshish. If we're more concerned about our houses and our jobs and the things that we do, then we're on our way to Tarshish. God has a message. He has a mission for us. He wants us to reach Nineveh. He wants us to do exactly what he tells us to do. Now, as you think of Tarshish, you think of two things. One, it was a place that offered pleasure. I want to tell you, you can have all the pleasure in the world, but that's not going to bring us peace. God wants to give us his peace. He wants to give us his presence with us. And the only way that that's going to happen is if we allow him to come into our life. See, the world offers you pleasure and excitement. People today are looking for excitement. They want more and more exciting things. You know, they come up with new roller coaster rides, you know, that people go to because they are exciting. And as I look at those things, I say, there is no way in the world that I'm going to get on that ride. Now, you know, when my kids were young and we went to a place that had rides, it was a very difficult experience for me. Because one of our kids, Vanessa, who's here, was and is very daring. And so she says, Dad, let's get on this ride. And I would say, let's not. But we would get on those rides, and it was torture. I want to tell you, it was torture. So people today are looking for excitement. Well, I want to tell you, God offers you eternity. Amen? Offers you eternity. People today are looking for fame. I want to tell you, God offers you fellowship. Amen? People today are looking for riches. God offers you righteousness. Amen? People today are looking for gold, the almighty dollar. God offers you himself. Amen? And so we find this prophet of God, instead of running to God, he was running from God. And he got on this boat. And as he got on this boat, the Bible says that he went to the lowest parts of the ship. And in the process of that, we find this this storm that kind of broke up in the middle of the ocean. And so it was a dangerous situation. Everybody was screaming. Everybody was running to and fro, trying to do something to save the ship and save themselves from certain destruction. Well, Mr. Jonah was unaware of what was happening. He didn't know because he was sleeping. And we said last week, you know, it is expected to find the world asleep. But what about us? What about you and me? What about us who profess to know God? What about us who have the Bible? What about us who know Jesus Christ? Are we awake or are we asleep? Well, the mariners were so afraid and so distraught that they tried to find places to hide and to save themselves. And in the process of doing that, they found Mr. Jonah asleep. And so they ask him, what are you doing, sleeper? And so he confessed to them that the reason why this storm came upon them was not because of them, but because of him. And so they said, well, we must do something. And he says, you know what? This is what you must do. You must throw me overboard. You must throw me over the ship into the ocean. Reluctantly, they did. And as you might imagine, Mr. Jonah was now in big trouble, right? Not only is it dangerous to be in a storm, but now he's in the water, sure he is going to die. And before he could kind of put that into his mind, as he was sinking down deeper and deeper into the ocean, behold, a fish, a great big fish, all of a sudden swallows him. And now, if he's thinking, you know, I'm not going to make it out of this water. Now he's really thinking, I'm not going to make it at all. I'm in trouble, swallowed by this fish. Who sent the fish? See, sometimes we think things happen to us, and we think that God is against us. Things happen to us, and we think that there is no way out. But I want to tell you, some of those things that happen to us for a purpose. Because God wants to save us. It wasn't that God sent this fish to destroy Jonah. He sent this fish to save Jonah. Amen? God is about salvation. And so As we think about the story of Jonah, we have to put ourselves in his shoes, right? So I want you to open your Bibles today to Jonah chapter 1 and verse 17. Jonah chapter 1, verse 17, the last verse in chapter 1. Jonah is one of those little books close to the end of the Old Testament. So Jonah chapter 1, verse 17. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. The Bible says, now the Lord, notice again, the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and how many nights? 3 days and three nights. And so this fish was prepared by God. Isn't it amazing that God spoke to Jonah and told him to go to Nineveh? And instead of going to Nineveh, he goes to Tarshish. Isn't it amazing that God speaks now to this fish, this great fish, and instead of the fish doing what it wants, it does exactly what God tells him to do? Could it be that sometimes animals are more readily to hear the voice of God than we are? That's all I'm going to say about that. Notice again that God is the one who sent this fish. It says to swallow Jonah. And Jonah is thinking, now my life is over. Now for sure, if I was not going to die in the water, I am for sure going to die in the belly of this fish. There is no way that I'm coming out. And so he spends the next 3 days in what I call motel fish. Motel fish. So the first point that I have here is this. The fish was sent to prepare Jonah for the task. Think about it. The fish was sent to prepare Jonah for the task. God wanted him to do something. God wanted him to go to Nineveh and preach his word, preach his message. But instead of doing that, he was on his way to Tarshish. Some situations that happen in our life, sometimes we question God. We say, God, why am I in this so-called prison? Why am I in this situation? I can't do anything. There is no way out. Why is it that this is happening to me? God has sent a fish your way in order to save you. Amen? In order to prepare you for the task. I want you to notice in Jonah chapter 2 and verse 1. So he's now in the belly of this fish. It is smelly, it is stinky, it is dark, it is reprehensible. He can't breathe, but yet he is alive. Amen. 3 days and three nights there in the belly of this fish. Now look at Jonah chapter 2 and verse 1. It says, then Jonah, what does he do? Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly. I want to tell you today, prayer is the best preparation for the mission that God has for you. He doesn't pray on the first day. He doesn't pray on the second day, but he prays now on the third day. How long? Does it take us to realize that God is in control? How long does it take us to realize that we can talk to God at any time? Amen? How long does it take us to realize that God has the best interest in mind for us? How long does it take us to open up our hearts to God and talk to Him as our friend? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, why don't you pray for me because you are closer to God? I want to tell you that's a fallacy. All of us can reach the throne of God. You don't have to have a degree. You don't have to have a title. You don't have to have a code, a special code to reach God. He is always open. He is always available. He is always listening. He is always there. He is always willing to do His will for us. Prayer is the best preparation for the mission that God has for you. After 3 days, Jonah decided to look up. Amen? Sometimes the only way to look up is if we are flat on our back. When everything is good and everything is running smoothly in our life, when we have food on the table and there is peace in the home and our bank account is good, when everything is going fine, very seldom do we take the time to seek God. Could it be that we have lost the science of prayer? Could it be that in our hurried lives, we don't take the time to commune with God as we should? Sometimes we say, I don't have time. But we have to make time, amen? Sometimes we have time for everything else, and then we find ourselves pushing prayer aside. When prayer is the breath of the soul, I want to tell you, in every situation that we're in, however desperate that situation may be, we can always find God. Amen? We can find God. Jonah remembered, hey, maybe I should pray to God. And so from the belly of this fish, he sent up a prayer. He sent up a prayer to God. What does he say? Verse 2, and he said, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he what? He answered me. When you pray, expect the answer from God. When you pray, expect the answer from God. Because you see, when you pray, the answer comes. Amen? When you pray, the heavens open. When you pray, the Holy Spirit descends upon you. When you pray, your burdens are lifted. When you pray, the future looks brighter. Amen? When you pray, you hear the voice of God. It puts you and I in touch with God. And so he says, I cried out to the Lord. Whatever it is, you can cry out to God. I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol, I cried, and you heard my voice. Be sure that when you and I pray to God, he listens to every word you say. Amen? He listens to every cry of the heart. It says, out of the belly of Sheol. The word Sheol is the grave. It's a Hebrew word that means the grave. Out of the belly of the grave, literally, he says, I cried. And you heard my voice. Verse 3, for you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me, and your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. I want to tell you today, there is a temple in heaven. Amen? There is a temple in heaven. And we have God the Father in the temple. And we have Jesus Christ, our advocate, our elder brother, our high priest in the temple. I know some years ago there was a controversy in our church that said that there was no heavenly sanctuary. There is no temple. And sometimes I wonder if some of the people that question this ever read passages like these. There is a temple in heaven. Right? Yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The Bible says in verse 5, the water surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you had brought up my life from the pit, oh my God. Now listen, he is in the belly of the fish, but yet he is seeing himself out of the belly of the fish already. That is what I call faith. Even though he is in there, he sees himself out of the belly of the fish already. It says, yet you have brought up my life from the pit, oh my God. When my soul fainted within me, verse 7, I remember the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into what? Your holy temple. There is help from heaven, amen? There is a Jesus who is willing to listen to our prayers. You know those battles that you fight that no one knows about? Those things that you face in your life that you say, when God, when am I going to have deliverance and victory over this? Those things Jesus hears, amen? Sometimes people cry themselves to sleep because of a situation that they're facing. Whatever it is, I want to tell you today, there is help in the temple. Amen? All we have to do is pray. Amen? I want to share with you just a couple of quotes from the book Christian Service, page 249. It says, we must individually hear him speaking to the heart. When every other voice is hushed, and in quietness, we wait for him. The silence of the soul makes more distinct the voice of God. He bids us be still and know that I am God. This is the effectual preparation for all who labor with God. She is emphasizing this quiet time that we spend with God in prayer. When every other voice is hushed, and in quietness we wait for him, it says the silence of the soul makes more distinct the voice of God. Be still and know that I am God. The best preparation that you and I can have for the mission that God has for us is prayer. Have you prayed about what God wants you to do? You know, as young people, sometimes they struggle with this thing. What am I going to do in life? What is God's purpose for me? What does he want me to do? Well, all you have to do is pray to God, and he'll show you, amen? He'll impress you. He'll tell you what you must do. Whatever situation we face, we can talk to God, amen? I found this thing the other day. It says, God has no phone, but I talk to him, amen? He has no Facebook, but he's still my friend. I tried to be friends with Doug Batchelor. And there is a limit as to the friends that people can have on Facebook. Well, evidently, he has reached that limit. And I cannot be his friend. I know who he is and everything, but I wanted to be his friend. But, the message came back to me. This person has reached its limit. Well, I want to tell you that's not the case with God. Amen. He wants all the friends in the world, amen? And he still has room for you and for me. There is room at the cross for you. Well, he doesn't have Twitter, but I can still follow him. Amen? Would you say that now Mr. Jonah is in an emergency? After spending 3 days and three nights in Motel Fish, would you say that now he is in trouble? I would say this is a big emergency, wouldn't you say that? I want to tell you this, your emergency is God's opportunity to work his power. What is it that you're facing? What troubles do you have? What emergency are you facing today? Whatever it is, your emergency is God's opportunity to work his power. Whatever it is, God is willing to help you. Amen? He's willing to help you. He's willing to strengthen you. And so the Bible says in verse 7 again, when my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord. And my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. There is no way that Satan can intercept your prayers. Every prayer that is prayed in faith, every prayer that is prayed with all of our hearts, reaches to the very heart of God. Amen? And he hears us. Those, in verse 8, who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. In the belly of the fish, he claims the promises of God. He claims the grace of God. From the belly of the fish, he says, salvation is of the Lord. Amen. I want to tell you, when you are down to nothing, God is up to something. Amen? When you're down to nothing, if you look at your bank account and you say, there is no way that I'm going to make it this month, pray to God. Ask him for help, and he will come through. Some years ago, we moved from one part of Indiana to another. And as we moved, we had a lot of expenses. And before you know it, at the beginning of the month, we had no more money. Has that ever happened to you? Well, that was not the only case. We had no more food. We were in trouble. And I told my wife, honey, we have a problem. Houston, we have a problem. We don't have any money. Well, why don't we look in savings? Honey, savings is gone. What are we going to do? And you know, I thank God for my wife. Because she said, why don't we pray? Why don't we pray? And so I said, what a novel idea. Let's pray. And so we prayed. God, you know our needs. You know that this is the beginning of the month and we have no money. Please, Lord, if there is a way that somehow you can answer our prayer, if there is a way that somehow we can have something to make it to the end of the month, please, Lord, do it in Jesus' name. I want to tell you, before the end of the prayer, the telephone rang, and I picked up the phone, and I said, hello, this is Pastor Jose. And on the other side was the treasurer of the conference, Mr. George Crumley. This is George Crumley from the conference. I said, hey, George, how are you? He says, well, we're doing good. How about you? I said, well, things are good. You know, that's what you say when people ask you, how are you? He says, well, the reason why I called you is because I was looking over the records and you've been employed with us for over a year. And we noticed that we have underpaid you for a whole year. And we have a check for you. Now, my question to you is this, he said. Do you want me to wait until the end of the month to send the check? Or do you want me to send it now? I said, you know, George, I'm glad you called. I think if you send it now, it would be good. He did. It was a check for over $5,000. I want to tell you, God is good. Amen? God is good. All the time. There is a Jesus who never leaves us. See, we mentioned that we asked the question last 2 weeks ago, who was lost in the story? Was it Nineveh or was it Jonah? Both of them were lost. And here we have this rebellious prophet running away from God, going as far away as he could, sleeping at the bottom of the boat. Yet God didn't leave him alone. We have this relentless grace that pursues this prophet. And this relentless grace is pursuing us today. Where are you? Where am I? Am I running from God? Or am I running to God? Whatever the case may be, there is a Savior in the temple, ready to help, ready to extend his hand towards you. And all you have to do is take hold of his hand, and he's going to pull you out of your situation. There is help and there is grace from Jesus Christ. And so we have this relentless grace from God that never leaves us. Do you think he's now ready to do what God says? He is ready. He's ready to get out. And as he's ready, the Bible says, the last verse, so God spoke to the fish. He spoke to the fish, and it says it vomited Jonah out on the shore. Even though he was covered with all kinds of gastric juices and everything was floating all around him, I want to tell you, he was glad to be out of there. He was happy to be out of there. Amen? I have this song that I want you to hear. And as you do, perhaps today, you realize that you have been running away from God, but you want to come back. Perhaps today you realize that you are in this situation and you think there is no way out. But today you're here. It is no accident that you're here, because there is a Savior. And you want to make a special commitment to him today. You want to say, God, here I am, with all my troubles and all my mistakes and all my faults, and today I want to come to you. I know we have a couple of people that have expressed the desire to be baptized. And I know Elizabeth Nunez said, I want to give my heart to God. I want to be baptized. She's going to be one of those persons that's going to be baptized in just a couple of weeks. But perhaps today God is speaking to you. And if you feel touched, and if you feel the need to come up, I want to have a special prayer for you as you hear this song. Come up. I want to pray for you.
I was lost when you found me here. You pulled me close and held me near. And And I'm a fool, but still you love. I'll be a fool for the King of Love. He gave me wings so I could fly.
Amen.
And gave me a soul to color the sky. And all I
Praise
have
God.
Is all from you. And all I want is all of you.
Praise
it's
the Lord.
Grace. Grace.
God bless you.
Nothing without you. Grace. Your grace shines on me. And there have been days when I've walked away. Much to carry, nothing left to say. Forgive me, Lord, when I'm weak and lost. You traded heaven for a wooden cross. And all these years, you've carried me. You've been my eyes when I could not see. Driving rain, your oil of gladness in the times of pain. It's grace, your grace. I'm nothing without you. Grace, your grace shines on me.
Our heads. Our Father and our God, today, here we are. Undeserving recipients of your grace. With problems, with issues, with things in our life, but yet we come. Lord, you see the hearts of the people who are here. Who have come up, expressing their desire to follow you. Father, there might be others who are sitting. Oh Lord, we pray for them right now. If you're there, if you're sitting, and you feel the need to come, I want you to come. Get up. Come, I want to pray for you. I don't want to end this prayer without having you included in this group of people who are here. Come. Wherever you are, get up. Why don't you come? Father. Thank you, Lord, that your grace never leaves us. Thank you that salvation was written all over the cross. And from the cross you cry out, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Forgive us, Lord, for our rebellion. Forgive us, Lord, for our apathy towards you and the things of God. But we pray, Lord, that your grace may find a place in our hearts, that we may open up our hearts fully to you, Lord. Bless the people who have come up. Bless those who are sitting down, Lord, today. Thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Let's all stand and sing our closing hymn, hymn number 590, Trust and Obey.